Good morning and welcome to the third meeting in 2023 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is a decision to take item 3 in private. Are members content to do so? Thank you. Our next item of business is an evidence session on the disability employment gap. The committee have agreed to take some initial work looking into how to identify and address the barriers that limit the ability of disabled people to get and keep employment. We launched a call for views, which will remain open until the 16th of February. And at our next meeting in a fortnight's time, the committee will hear from the Minister for Just Transition, Employment and Fair Work. We will plan to return to this work later in the year. I welcome this morning Emma Congreve, Deputy Director, Fraser Valander Institute, alongside Ashley Ryan, Director of Enable Works, Enable Scotland. And if members could keep their questions and answers as concise as possible, we'll get through as much as possible this morning. Maybe ask, come to Ashley first. So in general, we have seen participation rates in the labour market for disabled people improve in the last 10 years. How has this been achieved, and what do you think the outlook is for the disabled population in terms of employment?
I think there's been a real focus on specialist support for disabled people across Scotland and putting in place a plan not only for participants but also to upskill employers, which I think is that ultimate key, because without that confidence in employers, you'll have seen it from COVID, disabled people were the first people to be furloughed and often the last people to be brought back to the workplace. So that real focus on disability support, you know, seen in local authorities such as Edinburgh and Dundee, has meant that we're seeing greater participation because it's grassroots third sector organisations that can reach participants perhaps that are not engaged in Job Centre or who are reticent to engage in Job Centre. But it's about providing that key support, and the key support is around aftercare as well. So it's not just about the support you put in before someone gets a job, it's about funding which has came through in the last few years around supporting someone after they get a job, which allows them to continue that work for a period of around about 6 months.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Ashley. I think Enable worked with Fraser Valander to produce the report recently. When there has been an increase in the amount of people who are in employment, is there some who are further away from the labour market? The report particularly focuses on those with learning disabilities, and the government does have a target. Do you have any insights into where a greater focus needs to be? I'll come to Ashley first, and then I'll ask Emma to come in.
The employment rate for people who have learning disabilities hasn't improved that much in Scotland in the last number of years. In fact, they are the most marginalised group of all of those groups. And that is because there has been a focus on things like 16-hour jobs and 35-hour jobs. And there is a massive postcode lottery as well, so we don't actually know the right numbers around people who have learning disabilities looking to access work because the data is just not there at the moment. We're relying on people being known to social work to be able to gather that data. And it's around that key aspect of supported employment. So supported employment, while the supported employment review confirmed it was in many areas, it's very inconsistent support. So it tends to be provided by third sector organisations or in small local authority. But what it is the most successful way of supporting someone with a learning disability into work. And it's a massive postcode lottery. If you're someone with a learning disability all the way up in Betty Hill, which is all the way in the north, east of Scotland, you're not accessing support because there's no one there to provide that support. And that is a massive challenge because while we're focusing on disability, and in some cases disability rates have improved, that learning disability rate has remained very static. That's despite organisations such as Enable Work supporting more than 5,500 people each year. We're getting more than 1,000 people into work, but those challenges remain, and they start before people go into work. They start in school. We're seeing consistent young people coming through school, 20% of them not achieving qualifications past level 2. That shouldn't be happening today. You know, we shouldn't see 20% of school leavers with a learning disability leaving school with no qualifications at all and nothing to show for it. And what we're seeing is there's a real lack of aspiration for that client group in school. So if you're a parent of a child with a learning disability, it's a very negative time when your child's diagnosed. And therefore what happens is you go through life being told what your child won't do and less about what your child will do. So therefore your aspirations are significantly lower. We're still seeing young people with learning disabilities leaving and going into supported college courses with no vocational focus. At the end of that 3 years, they fall off a precipice where what happens next? If you leave school and you don't have a positive destination, you're 5 times more likely to be unemployed by the age of 25. That creates a reliance on the welfare state, creates a reliance on benefits, and many of these young people have aspirations to do something more, but we're just not getting that support right for them, even at that very early stage, because employment starts way before a young person leaves school. It starts as young as primary.
Mm-hmm. So would you describe the barriers? Because I think often when we think about disability employment gap, we maybe think the solution is the same for everybody, or the, you know, employers need to all do the same things in order to support more people into work. But are there different barriers for people who are living with different disabilities?
Absolutely. We're seeing increases, significant increases in mental health concerns around our client group. So we have to support them to think about their primary barrier, and sometimes their lack of confidence, their lack of aspiration, their lack of ability or belief in themselves is a massive barrier for them, and we have to work heavily to overcome some of that key problem. So we are working with young people much earlier to say, get them out the house, get them out and get them engaging in their community. They're very disengaged or perhaps not engaging at all. COVID has put them back in their homes for a very long time. The statistics around learning disability and COVID have made young people and adults very afraid to be outside and be unwell, and statistics around people dying who had learning disabilities. So there's a lot of work to be done at the beginning to, in order to prepare them for when they come to work, that they're confident and they're able to access the employment support.
Thank you. Emma, the report, I suppose part of the initial question I asked was about the outlook for continued progress. So we recognise there has been progress in disabled people getting into employment, but what does the picture look like for continued progress? The government do have a target to reach to, you know, increase it to, I think it's 50% of the population to be in employment. Do you think they're on track to meet that target?
So the target the Scottish Government has is about halving the disability employment gap. So that's the difference between number of disabled people who are working and the number of non-disabled people who are working. So they have made some progress towards that. I think there are two things to consider here. So on one side, you need to look at what's happening to the disabled population, and that is growing. To be clear on the definitions, when a disabled person it's a bit of a tick box exercise. You say that you have an impairment or an illness or a condition that's expected to last more than 12 months, and that limits your day-to-day life, either a little or a lot. So that's the disability definition we're talking about in these statistics. And generally, that's the Equality Act definition. We tend to use. So you see, we have seen an increase in the size of the disabled population, and particularly through COVID. The drivers of that, I'll come back to issues with the data, but seem to be around mental health, particularly evidence from across the UK has seen an increase in mental health conditions in that are leading to people falling under that disabled definition. And also that kind of other illness, other disabilities, which may be long COVID, but it's very difficult to know that conclusively. So the size of the disabled population has increased, which of course then has an impact on the disability employment gap. One thing to say is these people that are kind of becoming newly, this terminology doesn't feel right, but newly disabled may be people who are, that are more likely to be employed because it's not been as long term. It's not them a lifelong condition that they are, that they have. It's something it's acquired. That seems to be what the evidence is pointing to, and so there's a reasonable chance that they were employed anyway, and so they may be leading to that improvement in the disability employment gap. Maybe leading to some of that improvement in the disability employment gap, particularly over the last few years. So we have to look at both sides of those figures in order to understand what's going on. So if that is the case, that it's more the improvement has been because the disabled population has increased and those people are more likely to be employed, then the question is, so what's happening to everyone else? Has there actually been improvement in employment rates of people who have been disabled before the pandemic? I think there's some quite distinctions that need to be made when looking at whether there's been an improvement or not.
Mm-hmm. And the report also made a number of recommendations around, you mentioned data. So, you know, you've described the difficulties there are with the number of adults who have identified disability within the employability gap. You also talked about an audit of current employability support schemes. And has there been any government, I know the report, I think it was 2021, has there been any government response to the report, or have you had any discussions with government about some of the recommendations around data and audits?
Yeah, so the report you're referring to was from a programme of work we did through 2020 and 2021, particularly on learning disabilities. And we are now returning to that project we're sort of partnering up a bit with Enable in order to do some of the dissemination of that. So that's where our kind of link comes in through that. Work we did prior was funded by a charity called Acorns to Choose and was separate from Enable, just to be clear. So that report very much found some really troubling issues with the data and some big kind of... It was very, very difficult to actually understand what was happening in the employability landscape. So at the time, we were kind of no one left behind, starting to become more prominent. That seemed to be the answer to any question we had, like no one left behind. We'll sort this out. But we still struggled to actually understand what no one left behind will do for disabled people. Like, how will it be different from what came before? What are what are those pathways? And to be honest, we haven't seen, although there's new documents have come out since, you know, there's now a shared measurement framework which they're working towards, that being, you know, helping to shine light on what's happening. A lot of that's still in development, so we're still not clear on what data is actually going to be gathered. So we are actually now doing a second round project, recognising that there's still many unanswered questions, where we're going to try and do that audit that we described, and also do a lot of work with data in terms of those who gather the data, including Scottish Government and the ONS, to be frank. They are quite poor on their disability data, mm-hmm. particularly disaggregated to Scotland. So, we're not seeing necessarily the progress on data we'd like to, but we do understand the Scottish Government recognises that they've got a lot to do there and are themselves trying to make progress, but these are difficult issues.
Thank you. And just one final question, then I'm going to invite Graeme Simpson in. Last week we had the Cabinet Secretary in around the budget, and there has been a £53 million cut to employability services. Now, the Cabinet Secretary did outline that this was more... It was money that wasn't committed. It was lack of opportunity that was being lost. It was necessary in a very struggling environment, you know, difficult financial situation that was a decision the government made. But do you have, I suppose, Ashley, in terms of there was a anticipation this money would be coming through, and that's now been removed. Do you have any comment on the employability landscape for people with disabilities and what kind of funding is required to deliver in that area?
We have obviously seen a slight decrease in the disability employment gap, but as Em alluded to, some of that could be related to people now. We've got higher numbers of people classed as economically inactive and higher people in Scotland claiming benefits related to their health. So while that looks like a decrease, it could be being masked by some of the things that Emma discussed. In terms of the funding landscape, what we're seeing is while youth unemployment has improved, there are still that key cohort of disabled young people and young people with complex barriers who are not able to access the support they require. And similarly for adults, so the disability employment gap is actually higher now amongst 35 to 49 year olds. And if we're seeing uptakes in older workers coming back into the workplace and that gap is actually higher, then that's creating the disproportionate opportunities for disabled people to access the world of work later in life. And challenges remain in terms of funding because we have to put that focus on that cohort of people who are not able to access support. So if we're seeing the employment rate increasing and we don't have the rates, it didn't go to the 21% that we thought it would, for youth unemployment and COVID, but there's still that key cohort of people who are not progressing. So if the employment rate for learning disability is still 4%, we have to see a real key focus on those groups because it's not improving for that group. The state statistics have remained very static for that group leaving school and then continue to be static for those people as they progress. And where we've seen really key successes is where local authorities have put real significant sustained provision in place. So one of our provisions in All in Edinburgh is a partnership of four other charities We're one of four, and it's been funded for the next 6 years. And that's the City of Edinburgh Council recognising that while they don't have all the funding answers right now, they recognise that this is a challenge that has to be supported and it has to be funded. And what that allows us to do as a partnership is retain staff. It allows us to qualify those staff, so they're all qualified in supported employment, they understand the client group, and they're there to be a sustained presence for that client group, and that is what is absolutely key and means that we're achieving highest rates of jobs in that client group than ever before. And it's because the local authority recognise the challenges, but recognise in funding, but recognise that this needs to be funded, and they've committed to funding that for the next 6 years, which is highly unusual.
Emma, do you want to come in?
Yeah, just on the cut in funding at the end of last year. So we had a bit of a look into this because it was quite a worrying development so late in the financial year, given the scale of the challenge we've got for disabled people and employment. We can understand the rationale given the money hadn't been allocated and it was a very tight year, tight settlement. So we understand those fiscal pressures and why it happened at that point in time. What's less clear is why that money hadn't been allocated by that point. Mm-hmm. What were the reasons there? Is it capacity in the system to get that money actually into, you know, the right place at the right time? If that money was in the budget, why did we get to that point? And as Ashley said, the certainty is such a key point for people providing these services, knowing the money's going to be there. Being able to plan, these disabled people often have very complex challenges and need a lot of support over a long period of time. It's not something that can be done in a few months necessarily. So you need that kind of certainty that money will be there. And the question people will be asking is, will we get to next October and then the same thing happens again? So I think it is, whilst understandable what happened, mm-hmm. It's concerning that we've got to that point with such a with an issue like this.
Hmm. Do you know if anybody, the 53 million, if it was anticipated that was coming, was there planning or expectations underway linked to that?
Well, it's very unclear. That's part of the reason I say quite a lot of this is, not publicly accessible information. And obviously, it's 32 local authorities. There's lots that has to go on here in terms of getting the money to the right places. But we haven't really, it's very hard to understand, as I said, why that money hadn't been allocated by that point. And I don't think we have the answer to that yet.
OK, thank you. Graham Simpson to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning. And thanks for coming in. I'm really interested in what you both had to say. And you both touched on data. And I was just thinking as you were speaking, it must be really difficult to know the true picture, because there'll be some people who maybe don't even realise that they've got a disability, if we're talking about mental health, people just struggle on, don't they? And I suppose you can correct me if I'm wrong, but you would presumably have to have some kind of diagnosis, you'd have to be flagged up somewhere to appear on the figures that you're talking about.
Yeah, it's a good question. For the definition of being a disabled person that we're talking about, because the Equality Act has a very clear definition, as I described earlier, to get that number in terms of the number of disabled people in the population, notwithstanding what you said about those that might not realise it, but actually there is a lot of data. That question is consistently asked across a lot of different surveys. So the ONS ask it in their surveys, the census asks it. We've got something called the core questions in Scotland. So that same question is asked across three of the big surveys, Scottish Government administer. So we've got, there's a lot of data on that particular question, which is really good. And that's really important. So the question is about whether you have a condition that is lasting longer than 12 months. And I think, mental health issues, I think you may fail at that hurdle in identifying that. I don't think you necessarily need a medical diagnosis, because you've got that kind of question around the extent to which it limits your life. So, there are, it's asked in a way that probably is us in the right way, I think, in order to sort of capture. But of course, it will miss people. The key issue, though, on the data is around it being disaggregated into the type of disability.
Yeah.
That data is very inconsistently asked across surveys. Sometimes it's asked in outdated language, which won't mean anything to people. I noted the Scottish Health Survey, hopefully they're changing it now, but it talked about mental incapacity for people with a learning disability, which is a very outdated term, you know, and there's no source of reliable data for Scotland on disaggregated disability. So to separate people out with physical disabilities from mental health, from learning disabilities. And that's really concerning because, as Convener mentioned, obviously it's different support required for different people.
Yeah.
And how do you know that you're getting the right support in place if you don't know who the people are? So in terms of planning, it's very worrying.
Yeah. I mean, you're absolutely right. There's such a variety of disabilities. We were just talking about mental health there, but there's physical disabilities and there's all sorts. And I just wonder, from your experience, maybe Ashley, you could answer this. Are we doing better for particular types of disability? Are there obvious glaring gaps where we should be improving?
So we've seen, obviously, in terms of learning disability statistics are pretty static, so the support can be varied. It's a bit of a postcode lottery. But we've also seen real challenges supporting or getting the right support for someone who has a visual impairment or someone who has hearing loss, because a lot of the traditional employability providers no longer do that. So it's very challenging. Being able to fund an interpreter to come in and support with BSL, someone who speaks BSL, is incredibly challenging. And if that's not built into a budget, then that can be, if you're talking £75 an hour to try and get an interpreter, it's not fair if someone can't access that support. But if the funding's not there to provide it, then it becomes a bit of a double-edged sword and people are struggling to get support in those key groups where they could absolutely go into the world of work and do something really great. And again, in terms of learning disability, it's very much a postcode lottery, so those are real challenges. So while we've seen some uptakes in someone who perhaps has a physical disability, where it's easier to understand the adaptations that are required for someone, then we can see real successes. Where we're struggling to see successes perhaps is more in learning disability, in the field of visual impairment, hearing loss, and also for people who have autism as well, we're seeing challenges. Because it's not as obvious for employers how to support those people, you can bring in equipment, you can widen access, but if someone has autism, how are you supporting them? It's a bit of a more complex minefield for employers. They're less likely to take that chance and they require specialist support perhaps in order to do that. And none of these adaptations tend to cost any money, but employers can often be in that mindset that it might cost them money, they might not be at work, and actually with the right support, employers are able to see that they kind of being able to represent the communities in which they serve in its entirety is really important. Post-COVID, we're seeing that employees want to work for organisations that represent them, that represent their communities, and that's really important. So that challenge for employers is not thinking about adaptations as things they can pay for, a lower desk, an open, you know, and thinking about the specialist support, which often doesn't actually cost any money.
Mm. So have you got examples that you could share with us, even if it's in writing, if you want, of good practice and not so good practice? Well, I suppose we want to hear the good practice, don't we? You know, who's doing things well, particularly for the disabilities that you describe that you can't see? You know, because it's quite obvious if you've got physical disability, maybe there's stuff that an employer can buy that would help. If it's not physical, it's maybe a bit more challenging.
Yeah, absolutely. We can share lots of examples. We can send them in writing. Some really great examples is we work with about 1,000 employers each year, some small, some medium, some large. So one of our biggest successes around, you know, for example, Diageo, who are a worldwide organisation, but their commitment to ED&I, it goes beyond a tick box to get disability confidence status. It goes into, at every level, everyone is entirely bought into supporting the communities in which they serve because they have a skills gap. They recognise they have an ageing workforce. workforce. They want to bring young people into their business. They want to bring new ideas and creativity. And we've had great successes out in the factories out in Shield Hall, where we've got a young man, Liam. I can share a video with the committee of his experience and coming into work. He's a young man who's autistic, who's came in and thrived in an environment where it was that shop factory mentality. And what we've done with them is built in a series of training at every level, because you have to have buy-in at every level. So Liam has a mentor that works with him. He's thrived in that environment. He's completed his modern apprenticeship, all of those things he didn't think he would do. And that was a real journey with Diageo, but that seeing that change in everyone's perspective around disability has been really, really exciting. And that partnership has so much opportunity, because it's such a growth sector in Scotland as well, in terms of food and drink and whisky. And unsurprisingly, they love going to the distilleries and having a visit, you know. So, but that's been a really exceptional example. They're a great organisation to work with.
Emma.
Yeah, just to come in on that, I mean, I think these descriptive examples of things that have worked well are really important to share. It's something that we do. We try and look at these case studies of what's worked well. What we struggle with is actually being able to look comprehensively across the piece to look at what didn't work well. So, you know, you get the good news stories and you can learn from them. Yeah. But actually, what we lack in Scotland across a range of areas, but it's potentially becoming more of an issue now that No One Left Behind is leading to more dispersed kind of funding and schemes, is that look at that comprehensive evaluation of what's happening in those areas, so that we actually hear about the challenges and the things that aren't working and the people who are being left behind, which will undoubtedly happen in some areas as things develop over the next few years. And we need to learn from that as well. So I'd really encourage, you know, looking for evidence on that more comprehensive evaluation piece, which is harder to do, but critical for evidence.
It is, but you're absolutely right. We shouldn't just be looking at the good stuff. That, you know, we should be looking at what's not worked, so you can learn from that. Convener, I'm happy to leave it
thank
there.
Thank you. Colin Smith, before by Fiona Heslop.
Can I just follow up on that point, Emma? Is the challenge that the fact that there's such a cocktail of different funding pots that they'll all have their own criteria and all have their own evaluation? I mean, is what you're arguing, that we should try to streamline that and actually bring the funds together?
No, not necessarily. You know, there's obviously pros and cons with different funding models, and, you know, we have no kind of particular view on whether the way we're going down is the right way or the wrong way. Even when the pots were centralised, and we see this with Fair Start Scotland and some of the other schemes, the evaluation that's in place is okay, but it doesn't get to the root of exactly what's kind of not working in those schemes. You know, the rates of success for disabled people are a lot lower in Fair Start Scotland than they are for the rest of the population that enter the scheme. So, but actually, why is that? What would have happened in the absence of the scheme? You know, what that kind of full picture of what difference do these support schemes make is really important. And to be honest, it doesn't matter whether it's centralised or decentralised. We still have problems in Scotland with that proper evaluation. It can be done at dispersed level. There's no reason why it couldn't be.
The consistency of the evaluation. And can I come back on the point about the recent cut in the budget? I mean, like yourself, I'm confused over the impact, because one of the issues organisations have been raising with me has been delays in allocating funding. Now, I'm not sure, and I don't know if this is something you picked up from your work, whether that delay was caused as a result of the £53 million just not being forthcoming, or there was actually just general delays in the whole system, because there seem to be a lot of organisations in a really precarious position at the moment, waiting for funding that normally would have been allocated, but didn't happen. Is that something you've picked up in your work?
I think Ashley might be able to comment on this one.
Absolutely. So the challenges remain for us, where we are asked to procure services with 6 months to go last year. So we were getting local authorities coming out saying, can you do 3 months of work? No, you can't do 3 months of work, because A, it's not ethical to recruit staff on three-month contracts. We're losing very qualified staff from employability by the bucket load at the moment, because organisations can't sustain their funding or have no ability to retain that funding. So we're getting to a point now where employability fund was ending. There was a significant delay in what came next, 6 months, 9 months. So those young people dropped off a precipice where they had no training agreements, they had no support, and as a result, not through anything, it was just significant delay. So we're still waiting at the moment on finding out what's happening next year. And if it gets through again next year, so many local authorities put out funding last year in October and November. You can't do anything in that space of time. You could, if under the principles of supported employment, you are not able to operate a good model because you can't do something in 10 weeks by the time you're getting to know someone. So if I bring in, put in a bid in October, they tell me in December, by the time I recruit someone, it could be February. What are you doing in 6 weeks? That is, it's unsustainable, and it's not ethical for us to bring in staff. So we operate.
So where are those delays coming from? So I mean, you touch on an issue that's really a major one for me with an organisation at the moment. They've had a funding application in for months. Scottish Government level. So where's the delays coming from? Why is it different this year than it was maybe two or three years ago? What's actually happened that's caused these delays?
In terms of perhaps the funding going out to local authorities and their ability to administer that quickly can be challenging for smaller local authorities because they don't have the big backing of huge departments. You know, thinking of very small local authorities, they find that really challenging. But also they didn't have confirmation of their funding, so was what we were told, whether that is, you know, that is based on the local authority advising us. Some of the local authorities that did hedge their bets and put out their funding then had their funding cut and had to go back to providers that they'd already given money to and said, I'm really sorry, your money's been cut. So local authorities are quite rightly reticent to put out funding because if they tell you you've won 100,000 then they've got to come back and you're only getting 50, that has wide ranging issues. So it did appear on what they've told us to be that there was significant delays in getting their grant letters administered and getting that information to them, and it still remains a challenge just now.
And just in general in terms of funding then, I mean, it does seem a bit of a lottery. I mean, you have groups that effectively employ people full time just chasing funding constantly. I mean, what do we need to do around streamlining that process, but making that more of a regular source of funding rather than that constant running around trying to get it? I mean, surely we need to do something around streamlining that process.
I mean, I think if you're a small organisation working in one or two local authorities, you have these challenges around you don't have a bid team and you don't have, so you're being overrun by private providers who are doing employability for profit, who have big bid teams. We don't have that luxury. That would be great, but we don't. But if you're also a national organisation, then I've got to then put resource into providing 32 different bids. 32 localised bids that have to be localised, quite rightly so, because you want to provide that service. But that also creates challenges because it takes people away from delivering frontline services. And in terms of things like with EF going and then that new service, that yearly funding is a massive challenge because I'm now at the point in January where if I don't know what I'm doing next year, you're considering whether staff are going to be here next year. And while we've been really lucky and not had any redundancies in more than 10 years, that's not the same for colleagues across the sector. It's incredibly challenging. So I'm on the board of TSEF, the exec board of TSEF, and we're hearing from members that they are incredibly concerned at the moment about the funding landscape.
Thank you. Fiona has thought to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Can I just follow up a bit on this? So trying to understand, the £53 million was intended as additional funding, so nobody's funding was actually cut. But the disruption of not knowing that whether that was coming or not may have actually delayed some of the contracts, do you think, the regular ones? We're trying to get a sense of, you know, what actually happened with that and its impact.
I think the honest answer is we don't know. Yeah. It's just not clear what happened in the lead up to that. And you're right, it was additional money. So it wasn't a cut to employability funding that year, but clearly that money was expected by someone somewhere.
That's what I'm trying to understand. Yeah. Were people sort of holding back commissioning because they thought they were going to have a larger amount? So actually they might have held back.
I think it does tie into what Ashley was saying, just about this general uncertainty about when funding letters are coming out. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the £53 million was on top of that, in a way, that kind of uncertainty. It just kind of created that further kind of, actually, they can just take, you know, big numbers away at short notice. But I think the real issue to to try and understand, which would be really helpful, is what happened over the course of the full year in terms of the funding agreements and the funding letters, and where are the issues in the system that kind of got us to that place, with that being able to happen, because clearly that money hadn't been allocated, and also the issues that it's leading to with particularly third sector providers being able to have certainty. Mm-hmm. And that's, it comes through local authorities to them, so there's a double level of uncertainty there. Okay. So clearly it should be a lot easier than this, and it's unclear why it's not.
Okay. And actually I was wanting to ask about partnership working, and obviously it's quite a complex landscape, we can understand that. I very much appreciate what you've said. So it's to try and understand some of the key partnerships, what is successful, but where are there challenges in terms of partnership, and where if we're going to try and move this agenda on, do we need to try and work on?
Yeah, and just as a follow-on from what Emma had said, we didn't necessarily see the same amount of money coming out into the third sector as you would have seen when it was centralised. So that's something to bear in mind, that things like employability fund that went wholly to third sector or to further education didn't seem to, when they'd moved out, come out. So that's where the challenges came from third sector, where that money didn't then flow through. It was perhaps filling gaps and making sure that employability provision at local authority level was kept, and it didn't necessarily flow out past that in some areas. In terms of partnerships, we lead the largest third sector partnership in Scotland at the moment in Dundee, and I know that some of the committee are going to go visit that on Monday. And that was a commitment to really strengthen and start to invest in the third sector and have that as a partnership, because we recognise that together we are significantly stronger. We want to offer a really clear landscape for clients. So what happens is, with those clients, they come into our service, a one-stop shop, and they're dependent on their needs, or the partner they work with is determined. So it's not that we're all fighting over the same clients, because you know what it's like, it becomes very competitive. And actually that works really, really well, because it works for the local authority. They only have to work with us as the lead partner, but they're able to work with 10 partners as a result. So we have a really significant, in Dundee, we work across the full authority. We work with everyone who has barriers. So we work with young parents, lone parent workers. We work with disabled clients. We have support services for mental health. But that's created a really clear landscape for the local authority to engage with us as a partnership, and for the client to engage with us, because they know they're coming in and getting the right service for them, and not come to us because we're desperate for a start or we need to make sure. So that's been a massive success. We're looking to replicate that work in other areas. So we're starting to see real progress, because local authorities recognise the benefits of that and able to, for them, only engage with a lead partner. So that prime model that you see in Fair Start, but not a prime, subprime, it's very much a partnership. It has a steering group. You'll get to see some of the benefits if you go and visit that on Monday.
Okay, and I think other colleagues might go into the play space, different geographies and impact. I was very struck what you said about aspirations of young people, and in terms of partnership, developing the young workforce is obviously a key player in the employability sector generally. Is there anything more that can be done, particularly about that, the young people in school? I mean, you talk about that early preparation, that it's what you can do as opposed to what you can't do. And is that partnership strong enough, or is there something that needs to be done more on young people with disabilities in schools, working with the developing young workforce?
Yes, so we're actually part of that partnership through, so we deliver in 70 schools through the Young Persons Guarantee and through DYW. But again, it is a postcode lottery, so we deliver that in Glasgow, Edinburgh, Dundee, Inverness, and down in Ayrshire. If you're not in those areas, there is a recognition that specialist support is not there. So, like I say, particularly in rural areas, there's significant challenges for those young people. We are seeing reports of young people not getting a work placement, so they get no work experience unless their mum or dad organises it. We see examples of a young person sitting under the stairs for a full year and they did nothing. So there are some real challenges, but what that is a recognition is, with developing young workforce bringing us in, that they don't do that specialist work. And it's more than careers advice and guidance, because our staff work with 25 young people on a one-to-one basis under the principles of supported employment. If you're a careers advisor with 1,000 young people in a big school like St Andrews in Glasgow, you can't provide that significant support. So our staff are with those clients for 4 years. So we are working with those families. We get them travel independent travel trained so they can get to their job, and we work with them alongside the teachers. So it's a real partnership model with teachers, because we recognise to allow them to focus on the education and we can focus on that work and that aspiration, but it probably doesn't go early enough. Mm-hmm. So we're working with those young people at age 14, because the thing around whether it's funded as education or funded as employment or funded as social care is a challenge. And in other countries, that's not a challenge. They fund it as one. So we don't go young enough. So the aspirations for young children in primary school and their families is a real challenge for us as well, because by the time we get them at 16, it's sometimes too late, because you've got parents who are very nervous about putting their young person out into the world.
That's a very helpful insight. And can I maybe switch to you, Emma, and look at the, I suppose it's the employment economics of this. Obviously, there's a moral responsibility to ensure everybody can take part in the workforce, but there's also an economic benefit to employers, and a tight labour market. Retention of staff is key, and you know, if there's any data about the kind of retention rates of people with disabilities in the work, in the workplace, that obviously helps that argument. But also that diversity that, you know, customers want to buy from companies that look like them, you know, and it's and that's recognising that wider, I suppose, perspective. So are we seeing shifts in understanding by employers to understand the benefits of employing people with disabilities? And also, is there something about the economic imperative in an ageing workforce, where if more older people are going to be in the workforce, people develop disabilities as they as they get older as well? So is that where it needs to be, particularly in a Scottish context? And is there anything that we can learn internationally as to how different countries view this from a quite clear economic employment perspective?
It's a very interesting question, and I'm not aware of studies that have quantified this kind of, you know, in a kind of economic sort of analysis.
Yeah.
Clearly, there's a lot of descriptive / anecdotal evidence about this when you speak to employers that are involved in some of the programs as kind of partners. Things like Breaking Barriers is a scheme that kind of works with Scottish Power, I think, isn't it, to kind of, within Strathclyde Business School, actually, it's a training and then a work placement, and you hear very strong kind of views in terms of the benefits that's brought to the employer and to the colleagues that they work with in the organisation. It's quite difficult to beyond that point where you've got those partner organisations to kind of get data from employers in terms of, you know, people who are disabled. Not all people will, you know, tell their employer they're disabled because fear of stigma. So the extent to which employers know, you know, people self-declare this to their employer. So in terms of getting that wide study in terms of retention, I think is quite difficult. And we don't want to just cherry pick those who are kind of, you know, sort of leading the pack in this. We want to be able to look across the piece. So something that things like the census might be able to help us with when that data comes out, to understand kind of what people have been, what work people are doing and where that's been and what some of that work history is. In terms of whether there's internationally there's better examples, so our work on this looking internationally has very much been for people with learning disabilities. And again, it's quite difficult to know, you know, who's if the different societies are viewing this differently. Yeah. Again, it can be quite anecdotal that, you know, there's been a study in one place that shows something good, or someone's visited somewhere and it's been really inspirational. I think it's fair to say these are challenges across the world, across the developed world, I guess, is our comparisons we look to. But I mean, one place where there's been some interesting work, and the government is very kind of active in this, is in New Zealand, and that might be a place to look in terms of some of their employability support and how they do it. But no, it's certainly it's challenging in terms of that kind of look, getting that data and robust kind of evidence across countries. But yeah, clearly there are economic benefits. You talked about an ageing workforce, and we have had the recent kind of post-pandemic, during the pandemic and post-pandemic, people leaving the labour force in their kind of 50s and 60s may potentially be partly due to ill health. There's a couple of things that I think are relevant here. One of them is relates to the NHS, actually, and the extent to which some of the issues around kind of surgeries for things as simple as like hip replacements, you know, and things that may be leading to people living for a longer amount of time with pain that means they can't work. I think that's, it's again, it's not, we have evidence here, it's more a correlation. Mm-hmm. We've got high waiting lists and we've got more older people declaring themselves inactive, and we think due to ill health. So I think that's one thing to consider. As I say, correlation, not necessarily causation here. But the second actually is a bit of a counter to that, in that some of these conditions, some of these acquired conditions, arthritis, sort of musculoskeletal conditions, actually employment rates are a bit higher for those conditions out of all of the kind of range of disabilities. And this is actually evidence from the UK I'm using, because we don't have the Scottish data. So, you know, it's relevant to the disability employment gap, but they're probably the less kind of problematic conditions in terms of employment, if you look across the whole mm-hmm. population of disabled people. And it is things like visual impairment, kind of severe autism, learning disabilities, where the real challenges are. So I think, yeah, but there are opportunities for people there to be in work, you know, particularly in some of the industries like hospitality, could be, you know, our big employers for people with learning disabilities and autism. And clearly there's benefits there because there's a shortage of the labour force. So, yeah, it should be a win-win, but it requires support in order to get to that place.
And Ash, is there anything you want to add to that, or I'll pass back to the convener?
I guess just in terms of, we've really tried to work closely with some of the growth sectors in Scotland around food and drink. We work closely with hospitality providers. The Breaking Barriers Partnership now includes EY, so we're looking at thinking about finance. So we've had great successes in the tech industry for people who have autism, who are able to go in and do cyber security. And what we're trying to do is open people's minds about these jobs, because there was an assumption that they would go into low-level, low-paying, that kind of entry-level jobs. And actually what we're seeing evidence is, with the right support, they're going into key growth sectors in Scotland, filling those skills gaps. But it's just about understanding for employers how they find that talent. It's about inclusive recruitment practices, because evidence does suggest, anecdotally, that they are... the retention is better if you have a workforce that represents your community, if it represents yourself. But there are key barriers around recruitment, you know, timed application forms, something we shouldn't see anymore. If you're dyslexic, you're going to fail out of that. We're seeing a maths test to go into a stock room. There's things that are key barriers that we can remove really, really easily if we can provide employers with the right support. But what we're showing is that there's a growing number of people looking to enter the workforce in key sectors where we have those gaps, and we just have to create the right pathways in which for mm-hmm. them to do that.
Thank you. Thanks.
Just before I bring in Maggie Chapman, Skills Development Scotland were anticipated to be on the panel today. For understandable reasons, they're not here this morning, but I don't know if you want to say a wee bit about kind of national bodies and national partnerships who are important to delivery in this area, because you've spoken about local authorities and the kind of postcode lottery, local delivery, but who are the national players here that are important in this?
We work really closely with Skills Development Scotland and how they support young people, also through the modern apprenticeships programmes as well. Obviously losing employability fund was a key issue for lots of providers and support in terms of that national picture. We do work with DWP, but there are challenges around that where they are perhaps going to... There's a lot of programmes in DWP, JETS and all of those new programmes that are job centre programmes, which means that perhaps those clients aren't filtering out into something like Fair Start Scotland or some of the local providers. But we try and work as nationally as possible, as well as with the national employability providers, you know, big examples like Barnardo's, ourselves, Street League, all of those, because we try and create as easy, most cohesive picture for clients as possible.
OK, thank you. Maggie Chapman, followed by Colin Beattie.
Thanks very much, Claire. Good morning, both. Thank you for joining us this morning and for what you've said and the information you've given us so far. I've got two broad areas of questioning, and they touch on things that Colin and Fiona picked up on too. Emma, you mentioned the strategies and plans that we have, and you said in response earlier that No One Left Behind was kind of seen as one of the answer to all questions and all challenges. Given the October 21 report that you had, that there were key recommendations in there around ensuring that reforms around strategies, plans, social security benefit design, the National Care Service, all of those things, how they work together. How, over the last 18 months, have you seen the progress that you would expect to see in that kind of linking, overarching, working together at that sort of level?
Yeah, I'm not sure we expected to see progress, to be honest. I think there's still big concerns there. It's not a new story, the difficulty in joining up across government. And we see it in a range of areas. And I think, it's difficult because what we know publicly might be very different from what's going on behind the scenes. I think that's one of the problems, that there's nothing really that appears to be joining up things like the National Care Service, Social Security and employability for disabled people, and taking the disabled person at the centre of that, and working out how all those systems support them. It feels very much like it's a silo approach. And and from some limited conversations we've had with officials, it's something they recognise but don't feel, you know, weren't able to kind of give a kind of firm yes, no, we're definitely doing this. So I would have questions over the extent to which those things are being joined up in practice.
Okay. And are there particular areas of weakness you see in your 2021 report? You talked specifically about unpaid carers and the relationship between unpaid carers themselves and the people who draw on unpaid care to function, never mind gain employability, but just to live. Are there other areas of particular weakness or particular, if not weakness, areas that we should be mindful of ensuring that we actually focus on for that joining up?
Yeah, so I think carers is a really important part of this because, you know, they're not counted in part of the disability employment gap, but clearly the person they're caring for, you know, is disabled. So it's having that impact on their ability to work as much as they would ideally like to. But again, that's, you know, it comes down to the social security element of that with carer support, but also the National Care Service is a huge part of that as well in terms of the right support being there for the person. I think the problem is that it's very difficult. We find it hard to find, you know, for anyone to have that overview of all of those moving parts. Yeah. And we find it very difficult. It's very easy for us to say they should be being joined up, but then it's very difficult to actually understand what is happening. And, you know, we will, in any report, you will see it talked about in terms of those different factors, but it's what's actually happening in practice. I mean, I think one thing I'd say about some of the reports from the government, so the most recent one being the Fair Work Action Plan, which did incorporate the disability employment gap kind of, you know, actions towards that. And we had a previous disability employment plan a few years ago now. When you look at the actions, which are very, you know, make a lot of sense, and I was part of the Short Life Working Group that kind of helped with some of that, and many other people, including SDS, were on that. What we didn't see from the previous plan, which and was actually an assessment of which of those actions had been taken forward, and whether they'd been taken forward, but what had been the impact of them,
right.
what had been resulted in that taking forward. It didn't necessarily have to be the number of people in employment, but just a kind of analysis of what happened and what they think the outcomes of that action were. Mm-hmm. And hence we get into the plan that's out now with another list of actions, but very little understanding of the impact that those actions will have. And it ties back to that evaluation point again, that evidence to actually say, we're going to do this because we think this will have a really big impact. We're going to do this because it's a gap and we need, it's a particular group of people, but we expect all of those people to benefit from this, you know, so you can then actually measure the impact. And that would help with some of the kind of being able to assess the extent to which things are joined up, because you would actually be reporting back on, you know, so if this action links to social security, then actually, so what happened in social security and what are the impact of that social security action is having back on the employability or employment target. So I think more scrutiny over reporting, I think, would be helpful when these actions are made, to kind of be able to return to them and actually figure out what happened and what they think the impact was of them. Otherwise, it's just impossible to know really what's going on and why, as I say, we don't really even know why the disability employment gap has improved, which actions that the government have put forward have led to that, if any. And that's quite a hard place to be.
and it makes follow-up strategies, what are they based on? There's kind of not that solid.
Absolutely.
I mean, it comes back to data and interpretation of collecting data in the first place, and then interpretation.
Yeah, but it's not just data. I think when we say data, people often then say, "Oh, we're doing a measurement framework," you know. Yeah, and actually, that's not. It's data. It's information, robust information, which can include quantitative data, but also can include other forms of information. So, it's that sort of transparency and clarity of what's happening and best estimates of what the impact of those things may be.
And I suppose the impact of, I was going to say, doing the wrong thing, and I don't mean that uncharitably, but Colin's point about, you know, single-year funding and only being, we've been talking about multi-year funding for decades now and still talking about it. So yeah, I think that's really helpful, gives us something to dig into. Ashley, if I can come to you, you spoke earlier about the really what I see as fitting into the social model of disability, as somebody's employment chances start long before they leave school. And I suppose one of the challenges is educating or society as a whole, so people understanding what they're entitled to, what support is out there, employers understanding how they can upskill, what they should be doing legally, never mind what they should be doing ethically or morally. And I'm just curious for you to unpick that a little bit more. How are we not getting the support for either people who need employment support or people who are providing employment to know what they can and should be doing? How are we not getting that right?
So we did a piece of research for Scottish Government that will probably be published soon around parental aspirations and aspirations in children that may be worth a review in terms of our teachers are not always equipped with the skills they require in order to support children who with learning disabilities come into their classroom. It's not a mandatory module in teachers' education. Right. But they will all know that many classrooms have young and children and young people who have additional support needs. So in their classroom, diagnosed or undiagnosed, which is also challenging. So we're not getting that part right really early because our teachers are not equipped with the knowledge to support that child and young person. It should become something that's mandatory for all teachers to, because particularly as Emma suggested, not children are coming into the classroom and that assumption to mainstream, you know, presumption to going into a mainstream class, they're not always going into an SEN school or a language and communication base. So if they're in a mainstream school, that support could be really vital and key. And then we continue to not think about transition until much later. So the transition bill could be a really key opportunity to really think about that much earlier, because transition for a young person with disability tends to happen in the last year of school, because actually you've got an awful lot of other things to worry about before that. But if we can start to talk about it much earlier, then we can prepare that young person and their family much earlier. But we tend to think of transition as the year of either they stayed on 6 year or 7 year, and we need to do that earlier. Also, in terms of employers, we don't ask them to report on these things, so it is anecdotal. The evidence they can talk about the diversity of that, but they tend to think that becoming a disability confident employer means that they've done that job done. Let's move on. And there's a key focus on ED&I. So the Shinkwin Commission, there was a key recommendations that came out of that. It's also worth a look at because it focused on business and it focused around how businesses can support more people into their business. And that spoke their language in terms of how they understand the benefits of things like the Purple Pound from an economic and entirely selfish and not moral testament. But it also got them to think about how they can make these adaptations and attract more talent into their business. But we're not upskilling employers enough, so employers are afraid of making the wrong decision or saying the wrong thing for absolutely the right reason, or if they've had a bad experience and their understanding of disability is incredibly poor in some areas. We get real successes with small to medium organisations who are doing it because they know someone or they're bringing in, but we're not putting enough emphasis on these large employers who have the ability to create real lasting change in Scotland because they're influencers and they're able to make that change. So some of the work that Sandy Begbie done around the Young Persons Guarantee and the aspirations around DYW were really key, but the reality of some of that is that it became a bit of a tick the box. You know, some organisations coming into a school, an ASN school, and they just come in once a quarter, and there's no real aspiration for those young people to go into their world, and no aspirations for them to go into work. And that's the bit we've probably not got right, because we brought it in and the ideas are fantastic, but the reality of it on the ground is not necessarily what, and because we don't have the evaluation.
And so with the reality not be the what's happening on the ground not matching the expectations, is that a capacity thing? Is that an understanding thing? Do you have a sense of where, you know, if those businesses are going into schools but not actually galvanising any continuity or any relationship?
I mean, there's some of it is tick the box to be involved in those sorts of programmes because they get their logo on the website and it looks great and they look like they're supporting. But actually the reality is that they perhaps don't have capacity. But it's no different from doing a recruitment event anywhere else. If you have a gap but you're not able to access people where they are, or you're not able to access disabled potential employees, then they just aren't seeing it in the same way because they're not recognising. So there's a huge focus in ED&I, but it tends to be in other elements of ED&I, so around race, around gender, but disability tends to come at the end of that. And actually there's a huge workforce out there that want to work that are just not able to access it.
So is there a role maybe for some kind of, I mean, disabled positive employers, there are different schemes, accreditation, that kind of thing. Is there a role for formalising that in a more coherent and more, standardised way across different business sectors to support employers understand what they should be doing and what they could be doing very easily?
Yeah, so we had some real successes through SUS, the Scottish Union for Supported Employment, and their Inclusive Workplace Awards, because actually it was much more cohesive around evidencing how you're an inclusive business rather than have you looked at your policy. And some of the disability confident can become a bit tick the box, whereas what the Inclusive Workplace Award was asking the employer to put some real emphasis and some work and some resource into this, and there was some real success. There's also been some success through the PSP, the apt PSP, which should also be worth looking at, because what that is encouraging employers to really think about diversity in their business and it not be tick the box. They have to invest in it. They have to put resource into it, so they're much more bought in. So we see greater success in those sorts of programmes than in something like Disability Confident, which becomes something that gets put on the website. Whereas having that real focus on it, and it does have to be a top-down approach, you have to have buy-in at every level, and that's where we see real success.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Colin Beattie, to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you, Vera. I'd like to explore a little bit more around an area that's been discussed a little bit already, which is in connection with the adaptations and so on that employers might have to make in order to accommodate disabled staff. Can you give maybe some more concrete examples of how working practices have changed or have been changed successfully in businesses in order to accommodate disabled people? Ashley, maybe I'll start with you.
We've had lots of success. So everyone talks about access to work as being the kind of hidden hero of sometimes no one really knows how to access it. There's some real challenges around access to work, taking months and months to come back to someone and getting that support in place. So some of those physical adaptations, software support, but we can put things in place. So thinking of a young man that we've worked with, things like we got him a personal evacuation plan because he was a young man who required music. He was very distracted in an office environment, a very excellent administrator, working on the computer, but very distracted by the environment. So what he did is he had music playing. The challenge was he liked to sing, so that became a challenge for everyone in the office. So the adaptation, as he became more confident in his role, is he had one headphone in, and now he has the radio playing in the background. So that adaptation cost that employer nothing, but it was something that had real meaning for that young person to continue in the world of work. We also think about mentors in the workplace. So you often get an informal mentor if you come into work. What we do is try and formalise that a little so that that employee has an understanding of who their mentor is. We look at making sure that training is accessible. So if you're going in and you're doing health and safety training, do you require a scribe to make sure that you can go through that training? All of these things are often provided by an organisation like Enable Works at no extra charge, or they're funded through provision, so that the employer actually doesn't cost them any money. But what we do is they have real impact on people looking to enter the world of work. So things like a personal evacuation plan if someone requires that support. But it's just about providing confidence to the employer. And what we also do for employers is come in at times of challenge. So we often find sometimes that an employer will come to us when it's too late and someone's perhaps lost their job because of behaviours or other things. And what we do is come back in at any point throughout that point, because we recognise that there could be challenges, and we come in and support both the employer and the employee. But all of those things don't cost money. They're not adaptations that cost a lot of money. They're basic adaptations that often happen informally. If you don't have a disability, you often get someone to show you around the office. What we do is do those things in advance. So that young man I'm talking about with music, we took him to his workplace in advance. He got to see it. He got to see if there was lights, if there was an issue, because he got sensory overload in some cases. So what we did is planned with the employer how we would look at his induction. And it's just about providing confidence for employers, and it's not always physical adaptations.
Now, you mentioned about Enable going in and providing support. You must be a bit limited in the resources you've got to be able to do that. And if you really start to achieve the targets that you'd like to in terms of disability employment, how would you cope?
I mean, we have the resource. So we have a dedicated ED&I team now that are funded to do that work, and they work really closely with employers, because we also recognise that employers are all at different parts of their journey. So some of them are well-versed and they're ready to go and start employing people, and some people are right at the very beginning where they don't have the policies or the procedures in place to support someone. That work is done as part of our supported employment commitment. So you work with a limited amount of people. So where it's challenging for us in programmes such as Fair Start Scotland is the model is set up where you're working with 65 clients. That's not supported employment. Supported employment is working with 20 clients, 25 clients. So that work is built into our employment coordinator's day. They work with those employers. We can provide job coaching. We've hired job coaches that just do job coaching, and they go around employers and they work with people, you know, intensively to deliver that support, because we recognise that it might be intensive at the beginning, but it drops off because the natural supports in the workplace start to take over the paid support, because none of the jobs we achieve are in supported workplaces. They're all in the open labour market, and that's really key as well, because it's about changing that mindset for people.
Do you think there's a role for the Scottish Government in helping support this?
Some of the public sector organisations can be quite challenging to look at adaptations, because see, when you're a big, big machine, it's very difficult to make changes quickly, and we recognise that. And I think sometimes it's about public sector organisations leading the way, because it's about how do we make our processes as accessible as possible to encourage others to do that, because I think we have to make sure that. And that can be quite challenging in big organisations.
Now, you've highlighted here examples of adaptations that have been made, fairly low-key, you know, the sort of thing that doesn't cost a lot of money and is really just training, really, to understand the needs of that person. What about more complex successes that you've had?
So we've had lots of success in areas where we have someone who has autism and they perhaps have more complex requirements, where we would work really intensively with the employer. So what we do is we do job carving. So that is making sure that the job is appropriate for that person. And that can sometimes mean that there's elements of the job that are not going to fit within that person's skill set. So what we do is we work with the employer to carve the job that they'll be most successful in, and that's part of that principle of supported employment. So for example, for that young man that we're just talking about, he really struggled with finance. So part of his role originally was to look at paying people for elements of finance, but he really, really struggled with it. What we agreed with the employer is we took that element away and we gave him something else that he was particularly good at. So it's working with an employer to carve that out. We've also had real successes where we've worked with a young man who is deaf, and he's now in hospitality as a sous chef, and he's now moved into being a pastry chef in one of the most luxury hotels in Scotland, but he couldn't get a job despite being probably one of the most qualified young men that I'd ever met, because no one would take a chance on him. And what we did is put adaptations in place in terms of lights. We also put adaptations in place of communication. We supported the employer to think about learning some basic BSL for that young man, but also he just became his talent. It was more about that specialist support and coming in and saying, this is what this young man has to offer. So he wasn't getting through the first stage in lots of employers. So what we did is come and did some of that work with him to say, this is this young man, this is his talent. And actually, he's been incredibly successful and is now working in a 5-star hotel in Scotland. But he couldn't get an interview, much less a job, through a basic practice without any support.
Emma, can I ask if you make a comment here?
Yeah, no, I don't think I've got much more to add on Ashley, who's obviously working much more on the day-to-day of this. But yeah, I think, so just 2 points, I think, in terms of understanding that funding models need to be inclusive of this type of expectation that this support is required. So if you look at sort of economic analysis of employability schemes, you do get this kind of, particularly where they're paid by results schemes, you do get this concept of creaming, where these sort of easy to get into employment people are put into employment. And the right funding model isn't always there for those with more complex needs, or it's not tailored enough to them. So I think that tells us that you know, some of the work that Enable do and others do, it's more expensive, but it does get you those results in a much more sustained way. In terms of what we understand from the evidence. So I think that the funding packages need to be right and understand that element. And secondly, you did talk about the public sector, so public sector as employers, and that is a feature of the most recent Fair Work Action Plan, where they have put down some commitments to how they feel the public sector needs to respond. And obviously the Scottish Government is the obviously, they wrote the report, so that's a good place to look in terms of how their practices are changing. So it is very difficult, particularly for big organisations, to sometimes get the machine to make the changes. And I think the Scottish Government, as an employer, probably struggles as much as anyone else. So it feels like with what's in the Fair Work Action Plan, actually, that's a really great place to look over the next few years for the Scottish, to see how the Scottish Government is faring with its own policies, and can actually dig into that and scrutinise it in a way you wouldn't be able to do with private sector.
Okay, thank you. Gordon MacDonald will be followed by Jamie Harker-Johnson.
Okay, thanks very much, convener. If we're to improve the situation for disabled people, we need to understand what has actually worked and build upon that. And looking at the labour market data, it says that under the Equality Act, disabled employment levels 9 years ago was at 40%. Now it's at 50%. That's a substantial 25% increase in employment levels. And the disability employment rate gap has dropped from 38.7 to 31.2, which is a 19% closure of that gap. So what has actually worked that we can look at as a good example? I know you touched, Ashley, about the partnership working at Dundee, but what parts of the Fairer Scotland Action Plan is actually delivering for disabled people that we can build upon?
It's probably just, again, that focus. So it's about allowing local authorities to to commit at a local level about what they require and recognising. Because while we've seen improvements in the disability employment gap, we're not seeing improvements in the areas we've talked around learning disability. Mm-hmm. So we are seeing improvements in people who have perhaps a physical disability, where, like we said already, the adaptations are more obvious. We are still seeing this consistent people who, you know, that group of cohort of people, learning disability rates are the most marginalised, so the improvement isn't there in the same way. And I think it's because we've got better at understanding adaptations from a physical perspective and not perhaps where it's not as obvious. Where it's working for us is around that commitment to thinking about those groups who are the most marginalised and around allowing us to put the key focus in, putting support in. It tends to be because it follows the principles of supported employment, because it allows us to put aftercare support in and it's funded. So where we find greater success is where commissioners have recognised that aftercare is a key part of the provision. So it's about looking at that whole life and thinking about where we've got joined up with housing, we've got joined up with health. And like someone asked earlier, how do we do that? And that the learning disability, autism and neurodiversity bill, again, is a key point where we could look at really enshrining that in that bill to say, how do we look at someone from a whole life perspective? Because often there's things around the levels of people with a learning disability living in poverty are quite staggering. The report's coming out that 20% of people are living in absolute poverty and those rates are getting worse. So where we've seen it working is where people have committed to providing that support for that cohort, who are often being missed by the traditional programmes, so where they're not accessing Fair Start. Our all-in models deliver 3 jobs for the cost of 1 job on a traditional supported employment model, but that's because we've had 6 years to get that provision right, because there was a commitment to putting that in at local authority level on a large scale. So in Edinburgh, we work with 800 people each year. The outcomes are really, really great. We're getting 45% job outcomes, but our sustainment rate is at 80% at 12 months. So it's because they have recognised the need to fund aftercare and we have that provision, and it's because it remains loyal to the principles of supported employment. That's why it works.
And in terms of employers, obviously there are vacancies across the whole sector, whether it's public, private or third sector. You talked earlier about 1,000 people a year you're getting into employment. Is it equal across the board, or is there certain sectors that it's easier to get placements for disabled people?
We find it most challenging to work with the public sector. At times, they're just big machines, so your ability to go and work with an HR department who are perhaps not based where you are, it can be challenging, and getting a big cog to move it is challenging, and we recognise those challenges, and it often relies on having a really excellent people manager. You know, you're in a big organisation, a public sector, you're often not being interviewed by your line manager, your eventual line manager, so that's become challenging in itself. We've seen some great strides in some of the NHS boards where they're looking at adaptations and they're really putting a focus on it, but we tend to get the greatest success, obviously, in the third sector, because their values are already enshrined, they understand. And then in the private sector, working with those small to medium businesses who we're able to engage with on a really personal level, because we are never going to sit as an organisation and put 10 people into Tesco into 10 jobs, because we operate on a right job, right person. So that means that you have to build a personal relationship with each business. So our employment coordinators have personal level relationships, and that's why public sector can sometimes be a bit challenging for us.
Right. Emma, is there anything you would like to add?
So just to go back to your first question, I think the fact that we're needing to ask that question and we're not able to give, you know, those full answers as to why have those statistics improved? And as I said right at the beginning, some of it is due to changes that aren't about getting people into work. It's just about its characteristics of the disabled people population that have changed. And we don't know those kind of breakdowns for which disabilities have had those successes. We know learning disabilities, well, we don't actually know what the employment rate for people with learning disabilities is. That's just data doesn't exist, but for all the data we have says it's incredibly low. But we're not really able to even understand that or track that properly over time. So the fact that we still don't know the answer to that question, and some very basic kind of understanding of the disaggregated data, it's just not there. I think it's really worrying that we're at that place still now.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you, Jamie Hardcore-Johnson, followed by Michelle Thompson.
Good morning. Thanks very much. There's some really interesting stuff come out today, and some of the areas that I was going to speak about or ask you about were have already been covered. But I represent the Highlands and Islands, obviously large area, remote rural populations. You've talked about postcode lotteries, but you've also talked about aftercare and how important that is. And I can only imagine that somebody living, say, in a very rural community, having to kind of travel in, there will be other barriers to that. And I was just wondering whether that is the case. What are some of the particular barriers those within remote rural communities face, and how we can address those?
Highlands and Islands is a perfect example of a really challenging landscape for people looking for work. So we deliver our all-in model in Highlands, and we committed to delivering it in the area. So we've got a staff member right all the way up in Wick. We've got staff in Golspie right over in Skye. We're probably one of the few providers that work across the local authority that do that, because everything tends to be Inverness-centric and people are expected to travel to Inverness or be provided a remote service. Where the challenges arise, particularly around the funding in that area, is that we're going to lose the grassroots organisations that work in areas like Betty Hill and Wick, and because they are much smaller, they're relying on funding to come through, and the funding model is changing and looking at becoming back to that hourly rate or pay by visit type rate, which is going to be incredibly challenging in those areas. The public transport system is so poor that the travelling expectation is not there. So what we've had to do is build a really cohesive remote offering with a bit of remote and a bit of in-person, because being a girl from Glasgow who built a bed in Highlands, not knowing how difficult it is to get to Ullapool was a real eye-opener. And those challenges persist. We've got 200 schools in the Highlands. We aren't able to access those schools because the funding model just isn't there for us to provide that support. So you're having to rely on third sector organisations to provide support because it's the right thing to do, rather than necessarily be funded to deliver that support. So we're seeing huge challenges. We've got the other challenges around the mix of barriers that someone would have. So, you know, our clients perhaps in WIC tend to present with multiple barriers. They have a learning disability, they tend to have addiction issues, there are significant mental health concerns. So we have to ensure that we have staff that are able to work and support those barriers, and that can be challenging because there's also a bit of a recruitment crisis in some of those rural areas, because the 9-to-5 Monday to Friday doesn't work necessarily. So if we're wanting to work with disabled parents or parents of disabled children, we're having to think really flexibly about providing support at night, providing support at the weekends, and trying to access some of those jobs, because there's again massive skills gaps that were filled with European workers and they're not able to fill the jobs, but we can't get people there and get them upskilled because the funding model's just not right in those rural areas. So we're seeing significant challenges. And then in the islands, you know, things like Shetland, it tends to be one provider or the local authority that delivers that work. And again, you're what they have the benefit of, because the employment rate is often really low, and the unemployment rate is often really low, is you can go in and have those personal relationships with employers. But what we're seeing is mass exodus of young people leaving these areas to come down into the central belt because they're not getting the ability to access those jobs.
Yeah, just going back to what you were talking before, I'd imagine all of those kind of parts of that have to be right. Otherwise, the whole system kind of essentially breaks down. Can I just come back to the funding and then perhaps come to Emma as well? From before I was an MSP, you know, we were talking about kind of multi-year funding and that kind of allowing organisations like yourselves to be able to make decisions which have a consistency over a number of years. Has there been any improvement of that? Is it still the same? Is it getting worse? What is the impact of that kind of, not quite hand-to-mouth, but, you know, short-term kind of funding?
So, perfect example, in the Highlands, our ESF funding's due to end on the 31st of March, and we still have no... We've had bids in since October that are sitting, we haven't had a result from them yet. We also have to recognise that local authorities are under significant pressures and challenges as well to get the money out the door, so it's not... We just don't know what's going to happen, so the concern is we're going to lose staff. We've not been able to recruit staff in the last 6 months because we're sitting with only 6 months, and the right thing to do is let people know that, and that's been really challenging. But we're at the point where we're now at the end of January with the promise of additional funding not quite there yet. So do we fund it ourselves and hope that comes out, or do we just stop that provision altogether? So there's going to be, again, a drop-off. ESF funding ending is going to be incredibly challenging, I think, in the next 12 months, because Shared Prosperity Fund money just isn't going to fill the gap.
Yeah, okay. Emma, sorry.
No, I've nothing to add.
Okay. Can I just ask for very quick, because I am kind of conscious of time, and perhaps it's a more general question, but you obviously there are many, many people out there that you're working with at the moment. In terms of the actual need for support, can you estimate how much that is compared to actually what you're able to deliver?
In the rural areas, we could fill the demand probably five times over. In some of the big cities, we tend to have waiting lists in most of our provision at early stages. So some of that really early stage one engagement, we have double the waiting lists. We just don't have the capacity or the funding to deliver that work, because we have to really loyally stick to the principles of supported employment, because we know it works for people. So that is challenging. We often are some of the only providers that take on more complex cases. I think one SDS worker said, "You take all the resources that no one else takes," was one of the comments, which is unfortunate. So we, in rural areas, the demand is high and the provision is not there. And in some of the central areas, again, because of the work that we do, we could fill the caseloads 2-3 times over.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Michelle Thompson.
Thank you so much for coming along today. This has been an absolutely fascinating session. I just wanted to pick up on one area that was mentioned at the start of it, but it would be useful to understand a bit more of the context and in particular the complexity, and that is around long COVID. We know it's extremely complex and there's a multitude of presenting symptoms that are being categorised, and there's a lot of work going on in that front, but it certainly has moved quite a number of people into the category of disabled. I just wanted to get a bit more of a sense of your opinion of complexity, and I'm very struck by what's been said thus far about data and data collection and disaggregation. But I'd just like you to flesh that out for me a bit more.
Yeah, so, I mean, something like long COVID, from what I understand it, in terms of the labour market data, just comes under the other category.
Right.
So in terms of what those conditions actually are, I don't think there's a detail there. And the labour force survey, because it's so frequent and there's not as much of a lag on it because it's quarterly, means we can actually look across the period of COVID. Some of the other big surveys are still, things like the... Like the Family Resources Survey, which is DWP, the Scottish Household Survey, Scottish Health Survey, they've still got 2019 data, so we don't have that understanding really of what's happened, and it's still an emerging picture, I think. So it's really difficult to know, if they're showing up as for a period you'd think that people were previously in employment, may have been on sick leave, and then there'll become a point maybe where they decide, okay, I'm not going to be able to go back, and that's when they'll start showing up in the inactive statistics in terms of the labour force survey. So it's something we're keeping an eye on, but as yet, it's difficult to know what's happened and the extent to which it will be permanent, and therefore the extent to which maybe funding and provision needs to shift to those people, because it's still quite a new issue. So, yeah, it's a really difficult one. I think what else came out of the pandemic, though, quite conclusively, was an increase in people not being employed because of mental health conditions. So I think that's probably, the numbers there are much bigger than the numbers in this other category. So if we were to focus on the impacts of the pandemic, I think those the mental health impacts are probably the most concerning. But again, it's for a slightly different reason than pandemic. It brought in new kind of reasons, a new trauma and new kind of triggers for mental health disorders. So to understand, there's more provision there in that mental health sphere, I believe, for employability support. But the numbers are big, and the numbers of people that are inactive because of mental health conditions are large.
Okay, I suppose a closing question. There's a couple. One, I'd like to know your kind of top two asks, both of you, for us as a committee, on two scenarios. a lot of what we've talked about today is recognising the very real challenges we have at the moment in terms of data, the economic climate that feeds into not getting the multi-year funding that people would like to see. So recognising that constraint, what would be your top two asks or things you'd like to put in the record? And correspondingly, if money was no object and control was no object, what would be your top two asks?
I could probably answer the first one more than the second one, because but in terms of what I think we could, what this committee could kind of find, it's painting that a clearer picture of what's happening in terms of the funding stream. So where it's coming from, how decisions are being made, where there are delays, and not necessarily, you know, well, obviously it's a problem if there are delays in different parts of the funding system from Scottish Government to local government out to providers, but actually understanding why that has been the case and what has been done to rectify that. So I think with a big change in a system in terms of shifting to the no one left behind model, there's going to be issues along the way, and the important thing is actually understanding what's been learned and what's being improved, and being able to say confidently that the Scottish Government know that they've got issues that they need to improve on. Mm-hmm. Like this kind of delays in funding packages and uncertainty is something that from all we've looked at can't continue, so it needs to be progress made there. But it's understandable perhaps why it's happened up until this point. I think that's how I'd commit it. Mm-hmm. And then secondly would be on data. We actually have I've got a report which I can send to the committee which the ONS did on disabled people's employment. It's a 2021 publication. But it doesn't disaggregate to Scotland, and the publicly available information that you get through, to be technical, it's called the end user license, that is available to people like us to look at some of the detailed data. The data we want on disabled people is not there in that data, and it should be, in order so that we can actually get that picture of Scotland. So actually ONS is someone to think about, as well as some of the Scottish Government statisticians in terms of that data picture. ONS have got a lot of work to do there too.
Mm-hmm. Ashley?
I suppose in terms of thinking about what's next, it would be around we recognise those specialist groups in terms of learning disability are not progressing, and really putting a focus on some of those groups that have perhaps stayed quite static for a number of years in terms of funding and provision, and also thinking about if what's next for Fair Start Scotland. We recognise that it has been a bit of a postcode lottery, that the model is not set up to perhaps deliver supported employment in the way that it should. So perhaps thinking about that is almost a separate thing to think about, if Fair Start Scotland too is going to be successful and create the rates that it needs to for disabled people. We have to think about that in a slightly different way, because it's not the same as supporting someone who can move into work quickly. It's a different model. The data is a concern, but the funding in terms of providing that continuity of support for clients and making it as least a complex landscape as possible. You know, our clients often tell us they have such a complex life, they have so many people paid to be in it, that we actually just have to really start to funnel that down so that they can make it as clear and as easy for them to access this support as possible. And in terms of the money was no object, we would need to start as that would absolutely be music to my ears, but in terms of
it's not going to happen.
But making sure we don't have that postcode lottery, because actually mm-hmm. for us it starts earlier. It doesn't start early enough. It needs to start as early as possible. We need to build aspirations for our children and young people in the same way that, because we've seen many children and young people with disability not being asked what they want to be when they grow up. We were all asked. So we have to create that aspiration as early as possible. So it's thinking about employment almost in a preventative measure, the way sometimes we think about criminal justice, about if we put that work in as early as possible, they no longer require our services later on, because they are able and confident and going into the workplace, you know, prepared and ready and there. So it would be about that transition piece. And again, that stuff about the postcode lottery of services in general, let's really start to make it as easy for clients to access and the work with employers. We have so much potential. We have so many skills gaps, so many key sectors with a workforce dying to get in there. We just have to start making it easier for them to do that.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. They were really helpful final answers. We do have the Minister in 2 weeks, and I'm sure these are issues that people want to raise with them. Just a final question around the Fairer Scotland for Disabled People action plan. I don't know, Emma, there has been a couple of progress reports. Would it be helpful? I think we're lacking maybe the most recent one. How important are progress reports? There is the 2038 commitment around halving the gap, but there's also, I think, a further commitment, 2023, to have 50% of disabled people in employment that goes up. Do you know how important is it that we get progress reports, and what are the kind of key indicators the government should be giving us? I know that there were some, the recent report kind of focused on particular areas around Social Security Scotland and around public bodies, but do seem quite narrow for the scale of the challenge that we're trying to address.
Yeah, I mean, these government strategies are always difficult to do for officials because, have to please a lot of people, and sometimes the more valuable work is actually, behind the scenes and not in what comes in these published documents, unfortunately. And the progress reports are very much about this is what we've done. We said we'd do this, we've done it. It doesn't really go... And when we came to the short life working group, I said I was on for disability employment. It was a question a lot of us were asking. So what has been the impact of these things that you've done? What do we know about what's worked and what hasn't worked? And that then helps you take into the next plan. This is what we're going to do, and this is what we think the impact will be. That's the slight issue we've got with the approach, these document strategies and then progress reports and measurement frameworks. They're processes. They're not really telling you about the evidence in terms of what has been achieved. They're not outcome focused. Mm-hmm. It's not easy to do. It's much easier to do a list of actions and then saying we've done that action. So that would be the critical thing in terms of actually understanding progress is shifting. Well, it's not even shifting because the Scottish Government has this outcome focus, but it's actually joining up the outcome focus into these types of reporting they do and these plans, so you understand actually what's changed over time.
Okay, thank you. Thank you both for your insights and contributions this morning. As I said, we will have the Minister here in a couple of weeks. We'll be putting some of these questions to him. And as Ashley highlighted, we're doing a visit on Monday to Dundee, to the Enable project. And we're also going to go to a National Autism Society Scotland project in the next couple of weeks. And this is a short piece of work which might lead on to more in-depth work further in the year. So thank you very much. I'll now move into private session.